no impossible with you. Oh, there's no heart you can't rescue, no war you can't win, no story so no.
Good morning, Crossview. Won't you stand together and worship with us?
Who am I that the highest king would welcome me?
it's so good to see you all here today. I just want to take a second and welcome you on behalf of Crossview Church. If it is your first time visiting us, we ask you to fill out the visitor information card, and you can find that in the chair back in front of you. If you can fill that out for us and either put it in the offering plate as it comes around in a little bit, or you can bring it up to our welcome desk out here by the front doors, we'd love to be able to shake hands with you, greet you a little bit more personally, and we also have a small gift for you as well. With that, let's go ahead and turn it over to Miss Debbie for some announcements.
Thank you. We've definitely got some amazing things going on at Crossview. First of all, today we want to welcome Brother Daryl Price and his wife here. We thank them for being here to speak today. The association, he's the director, the executive director at the Noonday Association of Churches, and he just has an amazing job, and he's been ministering to us and our needs all this time through the surgery and on. So we thank you, Daryl, for being here, and just are so appreciative of your being able to speak for us today, and God's blessing you. Also today, we feed the homeless, so right after the church service. But let me back up for a second, because right at the end of the service today, we are starting our deacon family ministry. And so our deacons are going to be in the back of the sanctuary, and you're going to join your deacon, and they're going to pray for you. So today we're going to have that as our deacon family ministry closure of the service. From here on in, we'll be doing it the last Sunday of the month, so that we don't interfere with the feeding of the homeless, which is where I'm at right now. This morning, right after service, we will meet. So we ask you to come join us. We need a team out there to support that ministry. We'll be taking a delicious meal to serve there at Shady Grove Baptist Church on Bell's Ferry. And we ask you to come and be blessed. It is an amazing blessing to serve the Lord there and to reach out in ministry in love through food. Ladies ministry, this Tuesday night, we'll be going and meeting at Provino's. If you've already Monday night. Why don't I say Tuesday? Sorry, Monday night. That's tomorrow. Okay, great. Tomorrow night at Provino's on Barrett Parkway, 6:30 p.m., and we're basically going to enjoy fellowship and good food and all that stuff. So come out tomorrow night to Provino's. Then Wednesday night, if you haven't joined the Ladies' Bible Study but you want to, feel free to come on. We're starting in James this week. We finished up Colossians, and this week we're going to be doing James chapter 1. And so come and read it before you come and just enjoy sharing what God's spoken to you about that scripture. We have a family movie night coming up the end of this month, April 27th. We'll be watching Disney's True Life Adventures, Jungle Cat, and that admission is free. All are welcome. All ages, we want to come. It's a family movie night. But that leads us right into preparation for Vacation Bible School. Our Vacation Bible School theme is the Great Jungle Journey. So we're watching a movie about the Jungle Cat and the great lion and cat of the jungle, and then we'll be having Vacation Bible School preparation start. Our Vacation Bible School is not until July 21st through the 25th, but we would love for you to sign up. If you will, there's a place in the back right under We Live Like Christ, Serve Like Christ. There is a jungle themed table. Take one of these little cards and put your name on it. If you can volunteer, if you're a child, you don't have to fill this out because you'll just come. But if you're an adult or a youth, we need your help. We need you to volunteer. So plan to see that and take that after service today and sign up to serve. Last thing is recovery. Celebrate Recovery happens every Friday night here, and the Lord continues to greatly bless that ministry, change lives, genuine worship, an opportunity to pray for one another and meet afterwards with one another and share what's going on in your life. So amazing opportunities await us this whole week. Not only that, but the Lord has opportunities for us, and He's planning them for us, and He turns our mourning into dancing, and He gives beauty for ashes, and He turns shame into glory, and He's the only one that can do that. So we're going to continue worshiping the Lord with Graves into Gardens this morning.
The world, but it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along. and put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. Because the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. Better than you, Lord, there's nothing.
when you know that, when you know that Jesus, when you know Christ, your Savior, in your heart, and as your Savior, you make him king of your heart, king of your life, king of your every day. This next song says, let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the drink, the fountain that I drink. Oh, he's my song. Sing that with us this morning. Worship the Lord, King of my heart. Let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. And let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. And you are good, you're good. Oh, yes, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, and let the king of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in my waves. Oh, he is my song. And let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. Sing that again. And let the king of my heart the wind inside my sails, the anchor in my waves. Oh, he is my song. And let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. You are good, you're good. Gonna let me down. You're never gonna let me down. Think about that. The fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song.
Amen.
As the ushers come forward, I'm going to read Psalms 130, verses 1 through 8. Out of the depths I call to you, Lord. Lord, listen to my voice. Let your ears be attentive to my cry for help. Lord, if you kept an account of iniquities, Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, so that you may be revered. I wait for the Lord. I wait and put my hope in his word. I wait for the Lord more than watchmen for the morning. More than watchmen for the morning, Israel. Put your hope in the Lord. For there is faithful love with the Lord, and with him is redemption in abundance, and he will redeem Israel from all its iniquities.
Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for this service so far, and for your Spirit, your Holy Spirit that fills this place, Lord, that permeates us. Use us to bring you glory. And this morning, Lord, as we give our tithes and our offerings, Lord, may it be sufficient to meet the needs, not only of Crossview Church here this week, but of the ministry that you've given us to do, Lord. I thank you for each one of the ministries that you've called this body of believers to do, and we ask your blessing over this offering today. Bless both the gift and the giver. Multiply it, Lord, and just thank you for what you're going to do through it. I ask all these things in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen.
And I know the tension of the now. I don't always understand. I don't always get to see. Lift my song.
Amen. Let's pray this morning as Brother Daryl comes. Lord, thank you so much for supplying every one of our needs, Lord. Thank you for this beautiful day to come in here and stand on holy ground to worship you, Lord. And we ask you, Lord, to speak through Brother Daryl. Use him and preach the word of God, Lord. And we pray that you would give us all ears to hear, eyes to see, and spirits that follow you, Lord, and to do exactly as you've called us to do when we leave this place today, Lord, to be your witnesses, to be your hands and your feet, Lord. Use us as your vessels. Now we just pray for this time of your word, the preaching of your word, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus is alive. You believe that? You know, the women went to the tomb, they saw it was empty, and they ran back to the disciples. And some of the disciples then would run back to the grave. And it's amazing how God does what he does. He gives us his witness. And today I'm going to be coming from the Gospel of Luke chapter 24. And I just want to kind of remind you and to just walk with you a little bit in this, what God's word would tell us about the resurrection. And first and foremost, I don't know if you have some of those moments in your life like I have, but think about what happened just 3 days before, as we go to Luke 24, 3 days before the most significant event in the history of the world had happened. The crucifixion of Jesus Christ, and we would hear it through Scripture, lightning and earthquake type of event, darkness that would cover the earth. And I don't know about you, but there are sometimes those kind of events. Some would call them watershed events. Other times they would call those events what, flashbulb moments. I don't know about you, but I know where I was the day I had a meeting, and they said, "Are we still meeting today?" I've answered the phone. "Are we still meeting today? Why wouldn't we meet? Have you seen the TV? 9/11 had happened." You probably remember where you were on 9/11 when you heard the news, right? It may be other things for you that you remember. I remember, as I was thinking about these flashbulb moments, I remember when we went to war with Desert Storm. And I remember riding in the truck. I was with two other people. And I remember, you know, when we heard that on the news, the somber reality that we are at war. I remember where I was when I heard that we were getting shut down because of a worldwide pandemic. Do you remember where you were? Do you remember some of those light bulb, kind of flashbulb moments in your life? Those moments where the personal and relevant and all these life-changing things that trigger emotions and kind of thinking about life and where you are in relation to the world and the community in which you live, that makes that moment seem a little bit more significant. For some of you, you know where you were when John F. Kennedy got shot. For some of you, it might be where you were when Martin Luther King was assassinated. There are moments all along the way that we can kind of look to. But I'm here to tell you today that Jesus Christ is alive. And today we're going to see one of those stories. And you can just imagine what was going on in this day when the reality of Jesus 3 days after, and they had heard that the grave was empty. They didn't know what was going on, but what we see is there's some disciples, they're walking on their way to Emmaus, and they're walking, they're talking about current events, and then someone comes up to them and says, "What are y'all talking about?" And you can just imagine, here they are, and as they're here on that road to Emmaus, we're going to pick up in Luke 24, and we're going to see those two. And basically, in verse 17 of chapter 24, Jesus hears these people talking about current events. And in verse 17, he says to them, "What are these words that you're exchanging with one another as you are walking?" And they literally, they're walking and they stop. It says they stood still. And you can just imagine, like, where have you been? What rock are you under? And they go on to say, they stood still, looking sad, and answered him and said, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem and unaware of these things which have happened here in these days?" And he said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "The things about Jesus the Nazarene, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word and in the sight of God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him up to the sentence of death and crucified him. But we were hoping that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all of this, it is the third day since these things have happened. But also some women among us amazed us when they were at the tomb early in the morning, came saying that they had seen visions of angels who said he was alive. And some who were with us, they went to the tomb and found it just exactly as the woman also had said to them, but him they did not see." And we'll pause the reading for there. Understand, in Luke's gospel, I have a question for you. Have you encountered the risen Lord? Because these men, they were traveling along, they were walking along, and Jesus, the Bible tells us just a little before we started reading, it tells us that they didn't recognize him. Their eyes were closed, and they were just thinking this was another ordinary traveler, someone walking through, and they're like, "What is going on?" Can I tell you, when they listen, you could say they look sad. The Bible says this, they look sad, and they were also, "We had hope." That's a past tense reality. They had put their hope in this one named Jesus, who was a prophet among them, who they would say that he was faithful, he was mighty in word and in deed, and yet he was crucified and buried. And they are hearing this news, but the connection hadn't happened to them, and they were, in this moment, as they were talking to the risen Lord, he's like, "What things?" And you know what? For us, I'm thankful. You know, I know y'all do celebrate recovery as a church here, and I'm thankful for many, many of the things that Saddleback has helped across the country do, and how they've done so many incredible things that has changed the world. But one of those things, you may remember that the worship leader there wrote the song, "He came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, our debt to pay, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high." And we are here today not because of a song, but can I tell you, have you encountered the risen Lord is dependent upon the reality of the resurrection. So first and foremost, I want you to know, to encounter the risen Lord, the resurrection has to be a reality. Do you hear that? To encounter the risen Lord, the resurrection has to be a reality. Can I tell you? He came, and it's not because we sing a song. It's not because we have a celebration, whether we do the bunny or don't do the bunny, whether we hide eggs or we don't hide eggs. It's not about a holiday or a holy day. The reality is he, Jesus, he lived, he shed his blood, he died, and he rose again. The grave is empty, and he is alive. And you need to know that. Fact is, the Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 17, he says, if Christ has not been raised, your faith, our faith, is futile. That's what the Apostle Paul would say, inspired in Scripture. And here these men walking down the road, these disciples walking down the road, when they're walking down the road, they're encountering Jesus, and he just says, it's interesting, what things? And they were just like, oh my goodness, all of these things Jesus had said this would happen. And could you imagine, like, they didn't answer this question, like what things? You know, I could just imagine, have you ever been so clueless about current events or so clueless about what's going on? And someone says, hey, have you heard about? And they're like, about what? And, you know, for us, we might say, like, where have you been, dude? Like, are you serious? Like, you don't know about this? Like, you didn't know this was reality? You hadn't seen the TV and saw the towers falling? You hadn't seen, you know, clip after clip after clip? Or you hadn't seen this thing? Or you didn't know this thing was going on? Could you imagine Jesus? Like, where have you been, dude? What things? Jesus could say, like, you know, like, where have I been? Hey, it just kind of flash back a little bit. Friday I was praying, drops of blood. I got kind of, one of my followers would trade silver, 30 pieces of silver, and get captive. I would go through a trial. I would go through though the person that had the power to give me pardon, he would say, I find no fault in this person, but the crowd would be, you know, stirred up to say, crucify him, crucify him. And because of the mob mentality, I would be handed over to be then beaten, crucified, died. And I just want to be very clear, this was not a result of the man-made schemes or the man-made orchestration or even the angry mob. This was God's plan A. This was what he had put together. And can I tell you, God, from the foundations of the earth, he knew what he would be doing. And only God alone forecasts and fulfills his promises. The Word of God tells us in Psalm, for example, it tells us in chapter 12, verse 6, the Word of the Lord are flawless. The words of the Lord are flawless. And then Psalm chapter 18, verse 30, it says again, the words of the Lord are flawless. He shields those who take refuge in them. And you can look throughout Psalms and you will see time and time and time again where God continues to affirm his word and the reality. Even in Psalm 130, that was part of the scripture reading we heard earlier, there was a testifying, there was a reality that we can trust in the Lord who would send deliverance. He would send a redeemer. He would do what he has promised he would do. And why this is important? Because what happens after God in Jesus walks up beside these folks, they're walking, and after he tells them what the women had seen in verse 25, and he, being Jesus, said to them, O foolish men, and slow to heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary for the Christ to suffer these things and to enter into his glory? And then in verse 27, and beginning with Moses, with all the prophets, he explained to them the scriptures concerning himself. Understand, I think this is important for us Because we need to understand that this encounter with the risen Lord is scripturally accurate. Understand, there might be, you know, again, we can do all kinds of things. We can look everywhere. We can look to all kinds of experiences. But what happens often is we kind of want to believe what we want to believe, so we keep really authenticating what we have in our false sense of reality, what the future might look like. Psychologists would say that's projection. We project on the future. We project on others what we think versus what we know. And it's important that Jesus, when he's walking, guess what he does? He says, let me take you back, beginning with Moses. And can you imagine in Genesis, and when you think about the flood, the whole thing of how Moses was basically, when you go through Moses with the Ten Commandments, you go all the way through, and you go all through the Scriptures, could you imagine Jesus just going person after person after person after person? I don't know about you, but there's times whenever I'd love to have that audio. I would love to hear Jesus himself from his words to those disciples' ears, what the Scripture would say. And it's important for us because we know, and I know, for example, that he lives, and I would even love that song, you know, he lives, he lives, I know he lives. He lives within my heart. And though my personal experience is real to me, and I can tell you time and time and time again whenever that reality makes the difference. Because it's not just a book that I believe in. It's not just, hey, here's God's holy word and I believe what it says. But there's also the experiential side of I know he lives because he lives within my heart. But I also know that there are people who would say, all that is just not true. Look at Scripture, and whether it's Josh McDowell who would write Evidence That Demands a Verdict, or it's someone like Lee Strobel who would be, you know, a case for Christ, there are people who started out saying, I don't believe, and when they start looking at Scripture, God reveals to them what he said is true, and he's walking on the road to Emmaus, and he's just basically saying, let's just walk through here. Come on, let's go back. Let's go back and let's look and let's talk about these realities. Well, about the closest thing I could get to a walk with Jesus on Emmaus Road is, in my library, I looked over and I saw this book as I prepared to preach. And this book is All the Most Messianic Prophecies of the Bible by Locklear. And what I can tell you is this whole book, he just begins to say, I want to just go through the book. And this might be more than Jesus said, but he's just saying, let's go and look and see what is going on with the prophecies. And what I love about this particular thing, he just in the introduction, I was talking to a couple of different pastors on Friday, and one pastor called, and you know, because y'all may not know this, but I have a sense of humor. It doesn't show up very often, or when I have my humor, you may not even recognize my humor, but to me it's funny in my mind, so I will amuse myself even if it doesn't amuse you. But I was talking to a preacher Friday morning, and then another one in the midday. And when I talked to them, I said, hey, what are you preaching Sunday? I have to preach Sunday. I might need a good sermon. And, you know, one person's preaching on He's Alive, and he's starting to hold, you know, begin through the Gospel of Luke, and he's starting with chapter 1, and another preacher. And I said, I'm just kidding. I really, you know, I've got a sermon. I'm working on what I'm working on. And I was telling a couple friends that just in the introduction of this book, I literally could do a series of sermons because it's so rich. And I could, you know, possibly put you on to sleep. You know, some of you are hanging on the edge of your seats now. And I could just go ahead and put you the rest of the way out, you know. And now they say sometimes, you know, like, hey, don't fret if people sleep through your sermon, because this is a hard, hard, hard world. And if people can get some rest in the sermon, you should be just glad to be doing ministry to them. So hey, sleep on, brother. Sleep on, sister. You know, but really and truly, what amazed me is like one, just on page 13, it's absolutely stunning that this person, he's just bringing up, saying, hey, I haven't even got to the book yet. I'm not even there yet, but I just want you to know that when you go through, he says, Luke the historian reminds us that Christ gave all the prophets witness in Acts chapter 10, and then we tabulate alphabetically all the persons who were named as prophets in the Scripture. And he lists Abraham and Aaron and Abacus, and then all the way through Zacharias and Zephaniah. And there's a whole list between there. And he just listened, and you know, just reading through and looking at all of those things, it's just amazing how one after the other after the other. But you start looking at these prophecies, the rest of the book about the prophecies concerning Christ, what we need to understand is over and over and over again, we see Scripture saying, He will come. There will be a provision. And you could go back to story after story, whether it's Noah and the flood, or whether that's, you know, just, you know, the Isaac, and think about Isaac and his son there. Think about how many times God would provide and give a type or foreshadowing of what Jesus Christ would do. And prophets may not have understood it, but if you know Scripture, over and over and over again, there is this witness that the Bible would speak of. And even here in our verse, where we're not going all the way there, but what I want you to know that he would speak, and it says in verse 44, we're not going all the way here, but there are my words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all these things which are written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. So God had Jesus fulfilling what he said he would do in Genesis when he said he would strike the head of that serpent and he would crush the penalty of sin on our behalf. And God did that for us. And I just want you to know that this encounter with these Emmaus disciples, understand, when God just says scripturally, here's why it happened, we need to know our faith is based on solid scripture and a reality that is undeniable. Number three, I want you to know, God will meet you where you are. You know, God will meet you where you are. These men were walking, and Jesus comes up alongside them. Jesus, he then later, when they broke bread together and they didn't recognize Jesus. You can look at the scripture. They didn't recognize Jesus until he prayed and blessed the meal. And then their eyes were open. Jesus disappears. They run back to Jerusalem with the other disciples gathered. And then Jesus appears to them. Can I tell you? What I want you to know is Jesus will meet you where you are. He came to them. He came to them, whether that was when he would visit with Mary Magdalene and he would tell her, hey, go tell the others that I'm alive, or whether that was these disciples on the Emmaus Road, or that was in the upper room, or when Thomas, who hadn't been in all of these other places, he would say, I will not believe unless I not only see him, but I need to touch his scars. And unless we condemn Thomas, understand, all the other disciples had seen him before they believed. And so Thomas he saw Jesus and he believed. And even in that encounter, Jesus would tell him, you see because you believe. But then he foreshadowed all of us who know Jesus. We believe because of the testimony and the witness of Scripture. And through the ages, people have shared over and over and over again about the reality of Jesus. Understand, God will meet you where you are. He came to me. I don't know how he came to you, but I can tell you story after story after story how he came to me personally. I can tell you as a kid on the third row of Martinez Baptist Church how one particular day, you know, after being in Sunday school, and I used to have a Bible that told me I knew all the books of the Bible. I think my Sunday school teacher graded on a curve because I don't know about all that. Or I forgot. But all I say is I know I was in Sunday school, but one Sunday, as the preacher preached, Grover C. Lee would preach, and I would be on the third row, and I would ask my mother if I could slip out and come down front, because I gave everything I knew that day to Jesus, because this wasn't just a plan of salvation for everybody. Whosoever will may come. But that day, God tapped Daryl Price on the shoulder and convicted him. And I can tell you all kinds of stories where conviction and reality, I can tell you back on the back row, or about three rows back at West Acres Baptist Church, when God came to me. And I remember that day he called me to ministry. And when he called me to ministry, I'm thinking, like, who, me? Like, who? What in the world would you ever do with me? And I am there, and nobody in the place knows what's going on. But I just remember conviction for me. With it felt like my face was getting red, and I knew God was saying go. And I was struggling, and I remember saying, well, I can just do it here at my seat. I can just do it here, and it's all good. God hears our prayers everywhere. And I just remember that still small voice and that conviction that I would think these words: if you can't be obedient in the safest place, the church, why will you ever do anything else? And I remember going down front, and I remember telling Larry Harmon, God's called me into ministry. And I was the first person out of West Acres Baptist Church to be called to ministry. And Larry, a former basketball player, was taller than me. And I remember looking up at Larry, and when I shared that with him, and he says he didn't remember this, but he had this very perplexed look on his face. And so my interpretation of that, he's thinking, God's getting desperate now? Or, I've never been here before, I don't know what to do next. I don't know what those two were, but all I know is I just saw what his face looked like, and it just didn't look like he was, you know, it's this encouraging face. I can tell you as a college student, even before I was called to ministry, how God would come and personally seek me out. And again, it's not Daryl. It's Scripture, like Zacchaeus, who was running along, and he got up in the tree, remember, to see Jesus. He was seeking Jesus, who was seeking him, and said, hey, Zacchaeus, come down. I need to stay at your place. So though Zacchaeus might have been leaning in trying to find Jesus, I tell you, God was far ahead of Zacchaeus, looking for him, calling him unto himself. And he does the same thing with me. He's doing the same thing with you. He has done it, and you have your own testimony. But I can tell you, just as he came to me, he will come to you. He will come to you, and he will draw you to himself. He will help you to see very clearly what you need to see. Just like in this passage of Scripture, there was a moment where their eyes were blind. They didn't even recognize Jesus. And then the Bible says their eyes were open. Can I ask you to think about, for me, God will use anything and everything throughout Scriptures that shows that. But things that we would never, ever, ever think about. I think about Balaam. and his transportation that day. And you remember how God just told Balaam, like, the donkey was smarter than the driver. And the driver kept trying to push the donkey through, and the donkey was being disobedient to the driver because the donkey was able to perceive what was really going on. And we would have in Scripture where God would use that donkey to speak. And I can tell you, he can do the same thing in your car, in my car. And we can keep trying to go, and we can keep trying to do. But God has a way to arrest us. God has a way to use that song, or use that experience, and to use that constant reality that you keep facing to get your attention and to say, I want you. And what I ask today is, will he open your eyes? Will you be willing to say, Lord, open my eyes? Thomas, I mentioned earlier, he would say, unless I see him, I'm not going to believe. But can I tell you, he wants to open your eyes. He wants you to know very clearly he loves you, he cares for you. And the reality of this message is, when this moment in history, just the same day of 3 days after the resurrection of Jesus, 3 days after the death of Jesus, he's resurrected, he's walking with these disciples on the way to Emmaus, and as he meets them where they are, they don't even understand it, but then he opens their eyes. You may not understand why God's allowing you to go through what you're going through, but do you know God wants to do something amazing in your life? And here's what I want you to know is, when God begins to work in you, it's one of my favorite verses of Scripture is 1 Thessalonians 1:5. And the Bible says there, our gospel came to you not simply with words, but the Holy Spirit, power, and deep conviction. You know how we lived among you for your sake. And can I tell you, I've experienced deep conviction. I experienced deep conviction, and I didn't know what was going on, because when I came to Jesus, I knew enough baseball, and I'm not a sports fan, but I knew you get three strikes and then you're out. And I knew enough Leonard Skinner who would say, give me 3 steps toward the door. And I just thought, when I came to God the very first time as a repentant adult college student, saying, Lord, just give me 3 chances. Lord, just help me. Give me an opportunity. And I can tell you, when God met me and started transforming my life, I can tell you story after story after story. I know there was a season in my life where I tried to quit, and I tried to clean up, and I tried to do this, and I just remember the day that God intervened in my brokenness, and really and truly, I heard just as clear in my mind, it wasn't an audible voice, but I heard this reality after trying and realizing I have tried over and over and over and over to clean myself up, to change my bad habit. And that day I heard that spirit speaking to my spirit and said, have you asked me? And I can tell you, that was a day of deliverance. And I was like, actually, I hadn't. Okay, I'm asking you now. That's how I knew how to pray. Like, okay, I'm asking you now. Help me. And I'm telling you, a day of deliverance. So I'm going to ask you today that you might Just respond to Him the way you need to. I don't know what that looks like, but it could be you may need to say, Lord, open my eyes. I don't know what to see. I don't know what's going on. It could be, Lord, show up in my pain, in my misery. Show up in my recovery. Show up in my habits and hang-ups. Show up in my success. Show up in my fortune. Show up in my busy, crazy life. Show up in my ongoing opportunities. He did it for these walking to Emmaus. He's done it throughout history. And He'll do it again. And here's what I really want you to know through Scripture. The Bible would tell us, taste and see that the Lord is good. The Bible would also say, because it is, I do believe there's a framework, God's part, my part, and their part. There's this framework that happens, but the Bible tells us we must believe that He exists, and He is the rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. Throughout Scripture, though He comes to us, the Scripture also says, Jesus speaking, come to me, all those who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He would say, my yoke is easy, my burden is light. I don't know where you find yourself, what season of life you're in, but my encouragement based on Luke chapter 24 is, as you look in Scripture, that we understand very clearly that we can be, oh, foolish men and slow to heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. And understand, He wasn't saying they were stupid. They were foolish. It was necessary for Christ to suffer these things and to enter into His glory. All that was done so we could have, He would tell later in this chapter, wait in Jerusalem until power comes from on high. But as believers, we have the Holy Spirit who is our helper, who gives us strength, who gives us conviction, who helps us when we can't help ourselves. So my question again to you today is, have you encountered the risen Lord? And then my second question, if not, why not? Maybe today is the day to ask the Lord to open your eyes. Maybe today's the day you need to repent and believe. Maybe today's that day you need to be about doing your part to come to Him. And then my last question, as we consider all this, that when we hear the Word of God, our job is to respond in obedience. When's the last time you had an encounter with the Lord like these on the Emmaus Road when He broke bread and He gave thanks? He would say, they would say, He disappeared, and they said, did not our hearts burn within us? Do you have that kind of passion, that kind of work going on in your life? And I want to tell you, God wants us to live passionate lives in holy surrender. Let's pray together. Father, we come this morning. You know every heart. You know the things that we go through. You know what's going on in every place. And we pray, Father, knowing that we are all broken people. We all are in need of continuous, ongoing work in our life, Father. So we thank You that You are the one who gives forgiveness, You extend new mercy, and You help us in our time of need. So I pray, Father, even now, that during this moment where we think about your work. Maybe today is a day that we need to respond publicly, and we need to do something privately at the altar and just give something to you. Maybe today's a day we need to grab a friend and say, hey, pray for me. I'm trusting the Lord to open my eyes or to break this bond, and I want to be public about it with you, my friend. Maybe it's a day that we stay just where we are and right where we are with honest prayer to you, that we just say, Lord, open my eyes. Father, help me to walk the way you want me to walk on this path that you have me walking. Maybe today's the day that you would say, Lord, there's more to this life than living and dying, more than just getting old and retiring. Maybe there's new places of service that you want someone to lean into. Father, I pray that you would be honored as hearts respond in obedience. Father, help us to do your will, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord above. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord above. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne. Amen. Let's pray. Let's close in prayer. Thank you, Lord, for what you've done today. Thank you for using the word, the scriptures, Lord, to take us to where you brought us, to where you can meet us and meet our needs and move us to where you want us to be, God. Continue that spirit in us. Continue leading us, directing us, guiding us, God, and meeting us where we are. We thank you so much for all that you've done, for dying on the cross, for rising again, for forgiveness of sins. Lord, we could go on with this list forever of all the things we thank you for. But take us out of this place, Lord, and I pray that you'd bless our day and help us to bless others as we serve you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Remember, we're going to meet our deacons in the back of the sanctuary this morning. Brother Jim?